I recently made a video discussing kinetic energy in 5 levels of difficulty from beginner to advanced, and many of you asked me to make a similar video for potential energy, so here we are. We'll look at what potential energy means on a very basic level, and then extend this to some more advanced concepts. If you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. I also want to mention here that this video is sponsored by Curiosity Box. A huge thanks to them. We'll talk more about the Curiosity Box in a moment. But for now, let's talk about potential energy. Level 1. What do physicists mean when they say potential energy? Well, defining potential energy is actually quite a tricky thing to do. For level 1, we'll go with the definition that potential energy is related to how objects are arranged relative to each other in space and the forces they exert on each other. Another commonly used definition is that potential energy is stored energy in any system we happen to be studying that can later turn into something like kinetic energy. To understand what we mean by both of these definitions, we'll take a look at a few examples of different types of potential energy. And just to keep things as concise as possible, we won't take a look at the general meaning of energy here. I've already done that in this video, so check it out up here if you're interested. Okay, so the type of potential energy that is most commonly taught first is gravitational potential energy. Let's imagine we have a ball and we raise it above the surface of the Earth, and then we hold it there. Now, because the Earth is constantly exerting a gravitational force on the ball, pulling it towards the center of the Earth, we say that the ball has some gravitational potential energy as a result of being in the Earth's gravitational field. At some other point in time, this gravitational potential energy could change to kinetic energy or movement energy, which neatly describes the second definition we looked at earlier. There is some stored energy that could be converted to another type at some point in the future. It's worth noting though that this energy is not necessarily stored in the ball. It's more a theoretical concept that allows us to work out what will happen to the ball later. But also, the first definition we looked at was to do with how objects were arranged in space relative to each other and the forces they exerted on each other. In this case, the ball has a specific amount of gravitational potential energy because it is exactly this high off the ground and because the Earth exerts this gravitational force on it. Let's look at another example of potential energy and how our two definitions apply here. Let's imagine we've got a spring attached to a wall at this end and then to a block at this end. This block is on the floor and does not have any friction acting on it, so it can slide back and forth freely. The only force acting on this block, then, is the force exerted by the spring. If we imagine pushing the block to the left and holding it there, we can imagine the compressed spring will exert a force back to the right trying to decompress. Since we're holding the block in place, though, with a force that balances this rightward force, we can say that there is potential energy stored in the spring, ready to be converted to the kinetic energy of the spring coils and block when we let go. Equally, we can say that this potential energy is directly related to the ends of the spring relative to each other. The spring has specific amounts of potential energy depending on how much it is compressed or on how much it is stretched. So these are two different types of potential energy. There are, of course, many more types such as electric potential energy, magnetic potential energy, chemical potential energy, and so on. And each is defined in slightly different ways depending on what is useful in our calculations, but all of them relate to either stored energy or to how objects are arranged relative to each other and the forces they exert on each other. So that's level 1, definitions of potential energy that we can express in words. Potential energy is a really useful theoretical concept that we can't exactly measure directly, but it's immensely helpful when calculating how much energy a system has or how that energy will be transferred in the future to some other type of energy, like kinetic energy. In level 2, we'll take a look at the two examples of potential energy we've already discussed, but we'll see how to calculate them exactly, rather than just using worded definitions. Before we look at level 2 though, I'd like to take a moment to thank the sponsor of this video, the Curiosity Box. Now, this is a fun subscription service for thinkers developed by the creators of Vsauce, so I have an idea. Curiosity. What if there was a box that was based all around it? Imagine being able to solve puzzles, learn science, and have fun doing it all at the same time. That's what the Curiosity Box has to offer. I'm not sure I can keep up the Michael impression for much longer, and it was terrible. Anyway, look, the Curiosity Box is a subscription box product that I find genuinely fun and engaging. There are so many cool things to unpack, and I think many of you will especially enjoy the different types of puzzles that come in the box. They're a really fun way to develop your lateral thinking skills. Aside from puzzles, you can also find STEM t-shirts, like this one for example, toys, science experiments, books, and downloadable games distributed throughout the boxes. And each box also comes with a set of curriculum cards, like these, that will explain the science behind everything in the box. And I think they're written in a clear, concise, and easy to understand way, which is why I really appreciate them. There's more than $100 value in each box for less than $50, and proceeds from every box sold go towards Alzheimer's research, which is super cool. So head over to curiositybox.com/path and enter the code PATH10, that's curiositybox.com/path and code PATH10 to save $10 on your subscription. A big thanks once again to the Curiosity Box for sponsoring this video. Now let's get back to potential energy. Level 2. So we've looked at two different kinds of potential energy, gravitational potential energy and elastic potential energy. Let's see how to calculate them numerically rather than just looking at a worded description. Beginning with gravitational potential energy, we can see that this type of potential energy must somehow depend on how far away our object is from the surface of the Earth, how strong the gravitational field of the Earth is, or in other words, how strongly the Earth pulls our object, and also some property of the object itself that determines the difference between how strongly the Earth pulls that object versus another object. Now, this last property that we're talking about, the property of the object itself, is actually its mass. An object with a larger mass in the same gravitational field and at the same height above the ground will have more gravitational potential energy than an object with less mass. Using one of our original definitions, this means more gravitational potential energy is stored here than for this object. This doesn't necessarily mean the object will fall any faster once we let it go, but the fact is this object will have more kinetic energy than this one because its mass is larger and kinetic energy also depends on the object's mass. G is how we encode the strength of the Earth's gravitational field. To understand this, we could imagine the same object being the same height above another planet with a much stronger gravitational field. In that situation, the object will have more gravitational potential energy in this stronger field because the planet will exert a larger gravitational force on the object than the Earth does. And of course, back on Earth, the further the object is from Earth, the higher its potential energy. In other words, the further it is, the more energy is stored, ready to be turned into kinetic energy when the object finally falls. Now, as it turns out, this equation is a bit of a simplification that only really applies when we're close enough to the Earth that we can treat the ground as being pretty much flat. But the good thing is that this is kind of true even for quite large heights, even as far up as the height at which aeroplanes fly in the sky. So, an object's gravitational potential energy is calculated by simply multiplying its mass with the strength of the gravitational field on Earth, which we usually take to be constant in most cases, and the height of the object above the ground. The elastic potential energy stored in the spring, however, is a bit more complicated. The first thing to understand is that every ideal spring, which is what we're dealing with here, we're dealing with theoretical ideal springs, each of these springs can be categorized by a property known as the spring constant, which we normally label with the letter K. A spring with a big spring constant is very tight, and even a tiny stretch or compression causes it to ping back to its natural length with a big force, whereas a small spring constant relates to a looser spring. The other thing worth noting is that an ideal spring stores potential energy when it is either compressed or stretched relative to its natural length. So if we compress it by this much, then we store some potential energy in it. And similarly, if we extend it by this much, we store some potential energy in it. So what we really want to deal with here is the extension, which we'll call x, of the spring. We can say that a positive value of x is an extension of the spring, and a negative value of x is a compression. This should tell us something interesting. Since we want the energy that is stored to increase when we extend or compress the spring, in order for our energy stored to be positive, our equation should have an x squared in it. This way, it doesn't matter whether x is positive or negative, x squared is always positive. And this is exactly what we end up seeing. The elastic potential energy stored in a spring is given by half kx squared. Now this looks very different to the gravitational potential energy equation from earlier. There's a factor of a half, and there's a squared quantity, and it only depends on two things rather than the three we saw for gravitational potential energy. We'll see why all of this is the case later. For now though, let's move on to level 3. You may have noticed in the gravitational potential energy section that I kept mentioning the height of the object was measured from the surface of the Earth. Well, it turns out that this is just a choice. With potential energy, we can choose the point that we say the potential energy is zero. Because really, what matters with potential energy is not how much an object has, but rather how the potential energy changes and what makes it change. For example, for a ball on the ground, we could say it has zero gravitational potential energy because how height h is measured from the ground. Or we could choose to say that h is measured from the basement, for example, in which case the ball already has this amount of gravitational potential energy. This does not matter. Both choices are valid. What is important, though, is how this energy changes. When we raise the ball by 2 meters, for example, the gravitational potential energy change is the same regardless of which we chose to be our zero point. The important thing is that once we decide where we put our zero point, we need to stick with it for the rest of the calculation. This is a common property of different kinds of potential energy. The point at which we say an object has zero potential energy is a choice, so we can choose the most convenient point for us. But once we choose it, we have to stick with it for the rest of the calculation, because what's important is how the gravitational potential energy changes. And regardless of which zero point we choose, the change in potential energy should be the same in all cases. Level 4. So here's the thing. We've seen how to calculate a couple of different kinds of potential energy. But where do these equations actually come from? Why do they look so different to each other despite both being different types of potential energy? Well, as we've seen, the potential energy of an object is closely related to the forces that are exerted on it. So for example, if we're talking about gravitational potential energy, the gravitational force acts on our ball as it is, for example, raised to a certain height in the field. In fact, in order to raise this ball up to this height, we had to exert a force on it against the force of gravity. We had to do some amount of work on the ball in order to get it up there. Now, keeping things very simple, we can calculate the work we did to get the ball to this position from here. It was the force we had to exert to move the ball this distance. Using the very basic definition of work, this is the force multiplied by the distance moved. Equivalently, we could calculate how much work the gravitational force would do if we were to let the ball go. It would give the ball some amount of kinetic energy, which means there was some stored energy to change it into this kinetic energy. In this case, we say the gravitational field is doing work on the object. And again, using the simple work formula, we can see that this is equal to the gravitational force, or weight, of the object, mg, multiplied by the distance we're thinking about, h. Hence, the gravitational potential energy equation looks like mgh. However, this equation for work is actually a simplification of the true formula, which looks more like this. This is a bit more daunting, it's got an integral sign in it, but essentially it just breaks down the motion of our object into extremely tiny chunks, infinitesimally small in fact. And at each point along the journey, we find the force exerted multiplied by the small distance moved. This is a more general formula because it allows us to account for, potentially, any changing force over time, as well as being more mathematically correct in ways that we won't go into here. And when we think about the elastic potential energy of a spring, this more correct work equation gives us the correct elastic potential energy equation that we're used to seeing. The force exerted by a spring is kx, and so when we integrate this, we get half kx squared. If we use just the basic force times distance work equation, we would be missing the factor of 1/2. Now for those of you that know about integration, notice how we aren't adding a constant of integration. That's because this is a definite integral with limits. The limits are the start and end point of the object's motion. And this is where things get interesting. What would happen if the object started and finished at the same point, but took a different path to get there? What's the change in its potential energy? Well, as we know from calculating potential energy for simple objects, we don't care how it gets from A to B. In the case of the ball, the only thing that matters is how much its height changes. And in the case of the spring, all that matters is the change in the extension of the spring. And that is because the forces that we are dealing with are level 5, conservative forces. These are forces that do work in such a way that this work only depends on the start and end positions of the object in space. Now, for the ball above the Earth, all we really care about is the height, not even the exact position. But that's only because of the amount of symmetry in our system here. If instead we had a really weird gravitational field, I don't know what object would have a gravitational field like this, but go with me here, then the only thing that would matter in calculating the potential energy would be the starting and ending position of our ball. And all of the forces for which we can define potential energy are indeed conservative. Gravity, the elastic force exerted by a spring, the electrostatic force between charged particles, and many more. Whereas non-conservative forces, those whose energy transfers do depend on the path taken through space, do not have an associated potential energy. Non-conservative forces often tend to be ones where we are using a simplification of a more complicated force that is actually being exerted. Examples of this include the friction on an object. The energy transfer due to friction very much does depend on the path that our object takes. And so this object appears non-conservative to us, dissipating lots of heat, even though it's a manifestation of electrostatic forces on a much smaller scale. You know, this video is already super long, but there's definitely a couple more levels that we could go into. I'd like to discuss the drawbacks and annoyances of using potential energy as a theoretical concept. For that reason, I'd like to make another video on potential energy. Let me know if you'd like to see it down below, and also tell me what other topics I should cover in n levels of difficulty, where n is greater than or equal to 3 and less than or equal to 7, probably, just my arbitrary choice. And with that said, I'm going to finish up here. Thank you so much for watching. Huge thanks to the Curiosity Box once again for sponsoring this video. Check out their link in the description below and use my discount code. Hit the like button and subscribe to this channel for more fun physics content. Also, check out my merch in the description as well. It's a quantum dice design based on a famous quote from Albert Einstein. And finally, a big thanks to all of my Giga patrons and all of my other patrons over on Patreon. That's also linked down below if you'd like to support me on there. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.